There we go. Well, let's turn in our Bibles this morning, starting a new book, and so that's always an exciting thing to do. We are going to be in the book of Hosea, and if you turn to, well, I don't have a particular page number here to turn to, but anyway, it's in the Old Testament, and it is the first book of the 12, what is referred to as the minor prophets, even though they're not minor. They are only minor because they're smaller in length as far as the prophecies go and all. But so if you would turn to the book of Hosea, it's between Daniel and what's the one on the other side of Joel? Okay, great. So if you turn to the book of Hosea, we can all be kind of there. Now we'll be in chapter 1 for the most part, but we are going to start in chapter 8. So we will advance to chapter 1, but we will start in chapter 8. So, right. Hosea will be in chapter 1, but if you would hold your finger in chapter 1, and the starting place would be chapter 8, and the name of the message this morning would be, they sow the wind and reap the whirlwind. So let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for your love for us, God, your word to us, and I pray, God, that it would be a word that would touch our lives and address the issues, Lord, that we have not only in the country, but also in each of our lives also, God. So we pray your blessing, your help to understand the things that that we go through, Lord God, and also, Lord, that there would be great encouragement and strength, Lord God, in this time this morning, that there would be a building up and a recognition of your hand upon Israel, but also upon us too individually. We ask your encouragement and again your strength and blessing through the time in Jesus' name. Amen. So the book of Hosea is, as I say, a minor prophet, but only named because of the length of the prophetic utterances in light of some like Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel, major prophets, only because the length, not because the weight or the prophecy or the things of God that are given to us. They're all powerful men because they spoke from the Lord. And so in Hosea, chapter 8, verse 1, set the trumpet to your mouth. He shall come like an eagle against the house of the Lord, because they have transgressed my covenant and rebelled against my law. Israel will cry to me, my God, we know you. Israel has rejected the good. The enemy will pursue him. They will set up kings, but I did, but not by me. They made princes, but I did not acknowledge them. From their silver and gold, they made idols for themselves that they might be cut off. Your calf is rejected, O Samaria. My anger is aroused against them. How long until they attain to innocence? far from Israel is even this: a workman made it, and it is not God. But the calf of Samaria shall be broken to pieces. In verse 7, they sow the wind, they reap the whirlwind. The stalk has not budded, if it shall never produce meal. If it should produce, aliens would swallow it up. Verse 8, Israel is swallowed up. Now they are among the Gentiles like a vessel in which no pleasure, in which is no pleasure. So this morning we see the message of the word to the nation of Israel. And it's an interesting area of scripture, as we can turn to chapter 1 and take a look at what this amazing prophecy has for us. It is certainly timely. It is certainly a lot of things in here that you can look at for the United States today, talking about the nation. And this is a word to the nation of Israel. But as is always the word of God, it's also a word to the nation of Israel. It's a word to the nation of the United States, but it's also a word to us individually. So we can have great, amazing comfort in the fact that God not only deals with the sin of the nations, but he also deals with our sin too. And that is always exciting for us to realize and know that God is working within our own lives along with the other things that are going on. Because the word to the nation of repent and chastisement and the things that we're going to be looking at here is not to land. It's to people. So therefore, the people in the nation that are being spoken to. And so as we look at the things that that Israel's involved in, the Lord would certainly have us to know that we too need to be encouraged, need to be exhorted, and obviously we need to repent of the things that we may be displeasing the Lord with in our lives. And so here is this amazing word to us. I like the idea of the warning in chapter 8, set the trumpet to your mouth. In other words, here's a warning that needs to go out. And perhaps it's certainly appropriate for the things going on in our nation this very day. So the title of the message is, they sow the wind and they reap the whirlwind. And so this, the idea of sowing, the idea of planting, the idea of putting something in for the fruit of it later on. And so here is Israel sowing the wind. What do you expect to gain from sowing the wind? Well, he tells us, and that is not very nice of a product, and that is the whirlwind that is going to come back to the nation of Israel. And so it's the idea of going on in life, the things going on in life as they sow, as they go about their daily lives, and therefore they're going about their daily lives, but they forget all about God. They don't think about him in their daily routines, in their festivals, and these kind of things. God is absent from them. And so this is also an area where they are divided kingdom. This word from Hosea is to the northern kingdom. It gives us an idea that he is a counterpart to someone like Isaiah and Micah, They were speaking to the southern kingdom. Hosea and Amos were speaking to the northern kingdom. However, probably Hosea, well, the first, we'll wait till the first verse before we go into that. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but this is kind of the context of that. And so what should they sow? They're sowing the wind, but what should they sow? Well, they should sow not the things of destruction, not the things of rebellion, not the things that don't honor the Lord. And that's what they were doing, going after other gods and being involved in worship of other gods. And so their sin was known by God. It was an ongoing thing. And so God is bringing this sin to them, and therefore he is going to judge them for that. But he is going to deal with them in an interesting way to begin with. And so he is called to live out an illustration in this particular first area of Hosea. And it will be interesting to say the least. And so, but I will through this time try to bring out the parallels that we can see in our day, in our personal lives, as also as far as the nation goes, because there are many of those that we can see quite clearly. And so the whole letter is designed to show what is being sown by Israel and the consequences of it. And so also to remember, as this teaches us very clearly, even in the first chapter, that all manner of sin and blasphemy will be forgiven us by the Lord. And so here is this area that we go to that is very interesting. So let's get to it in chapter 1. The word of the Lord that came to Hosea, the son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, in all the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. And so as you start immediately, here we have a prophet to the northern kingdom. However, he speaks of the kings and mentions the kings of the southern kingdom of Judah. And so interesting that he would mention that. He spoke of one, that is the northern kingdom, and that is the present king that he is personally under in the northern kingdom, and that is Jeroboam, as we see as he speaks to these individuals. And so he has spoken during these particular days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. And so whether it is the idea of recognizing the legitimate kingdom of the south in the Davidic type of line of kings, or just what it is, maybe it's the illegitimate nation of Israel. So whichever one it is, whichever reason, for whatever reason, he mentions the kings of Judah and in an honorable type of fashion, and the idea of the northern kingdom, there was not any good kings. And so therefore, I can see why he would not want to mention those kings that were so ruthless, and they killed one another, and you know, and this kind of thing, destroy the kingdom of Ahab completely, and killed all of the heirs to the throne and all, as Jehu came and took over, and then Jeroboam was King Jeroboam 1, and this is Jeroboam number 2. So we have interesting line here of the kings. But you notice the focus. The focus is not on the kings. The focus here is on, number one, the prophet, and number two, his life itself and the things that are going on later on in Israel. And so it's not necessarily the king that is going on. It's not Washington, D.C., you know. It is it's the idea of how they are not honoring the Lord in the country of Israel. So therefore, the focus here is interesting. And right away, we're going to get a focus, and it's going to be different. So verse 2, when the Lord began to speak by Hosea, the Lord said to Hosea, go take yourself a wife of harlotry and children of harlotry. And children of harlotry, for the land has committed great harlotry by departing from the Lord. And so now the reasoning here. We're talking about the nation here in particular. He's referring to the nation, but he's saying to Hosea, we're going to speak to the nation, to the people in the nation, but I'm going to use your life as an example of the nation and a relationship with me. So this is not individually, in particularly, talking about marriage. It's not talking about the things that are involved in that kind of relationship, whether it is right or not for him to marry this kind of a person. It's not even going into all of that, which all of these things are brought up when you start reading in this area. You can imagine all the issues coming up in God telling a man that's going to speak his word to go and take a wife of harlotry and a children of harlotry, for the land has committed great harlotry. And so the idea, though, is we're referencing a nation here, and the example here is, and the illustration that we have is for the nation of Israel and the marriage relationship of Hosea and Gomer. So in verse 3, so he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Delibam, and she conceived and bore him a son. Then the Lord said to him, call his name Jezreel, for in a little while I will avenge the bloodshed of Jezreel of the house of Jehu and bring an end to the kingdom of the house of Israel. It shall come to pass in that day that I will break the bow of Israel in the valley of Jezreel. And she conceived again and bore a daughter. Then God said to him, call her name Loruhamah, for I will no longer have mercy on the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away. Yet I will have mercy on the house of Judah. I will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor by sword or battle, by horse or horseman. Now, when she has weaned Loruhamah, she conceived and bore a son. Then God said, call his name Lo-Ami, for you are not my people. I will not be your God. So here is this interesting story about Hosea, who is told in verse 2, he began to speak. The first thing he was speaking to Hosea is the fact that go take yourself a wife of harlotry. And so, interesting that is brought up in many of the writings, or some of them that I was reading and all. And And also you go to the different areas in Scripture. And for a priest to marry a prostitute, that is against their law there. And also was, as one mentioned, no one in here says that he is a priest. No one has said who he is other than God called him as a prophet. So so at that point, it doesn't matter if God tells you to do something, what are you going to do? You're going to say, yes, sir. That's what I'm going to do. God says, you know, go do this. And Hosea immediately goes to do this very thing, even though it's quite a disgusting type thing to do. So, but he says, go take yourself a wife of harlotry. Now, that's important wording right there, because many will say this is just an allegory or that kind of thing. Or she wasn't really a harlot, but she turned out to be a harlot after they got married. And kind of, you know, they kind of like to divide all these kind of things up, but very clearly, the Lord here says that he needs to go and take a wife of harlotry and children of harlotry, and therefore he's telling them why. For the land has committed great harlotry. And how's that? By departing from God. And so this is the issue. These individuals have departed from God, and so therefore they're going to be being instructed by a prophet and being chastised by a prophet and asked to repent by a prophet. And so therefore, God wants to work within Hosea the commitment level that he needs for that man to be able to give that message in that way to those people that he needs to speak to. God shows his amazing power and amazing love. And even through something like this kind of a relationship with Hosea, and in verse 3, so he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Dibleam. And so he took Gomer. And so interesting it is, just to say right off, that this book, just to be kind of blunt, is kind of depressing. It is kind of depressing from this point of view of judgment. But yet we see God working in amazing ways, and you can see some of these things that that God has Hosea to say. I mean, this is where we get the phrase, sow to the wind, you reap the whirlwind. And so that's something that we need to keep in mind. We sow the wind, the nothing, then the whirlwind comes around. If we sow sin, if we sow disobedience, then that kind of thing is going to come right back to us. And so here is this idea that that God is using this kind of a parallel in the life of his prophet. And so Israel is majoring in sin of biblical proportions. And so they are, that was a little humor, but this is of biblical proportions. They're majoring in sin. They have walked away from God. Now reckoning is coming to them. And so now we have such this kind of a work going on in Hosea so that he would be prepared. Evidently, God knew what Hosea needed in his life. If you're married, you know it's a constant reminder every single day your wife and your husband are together, and therefore you have that relationship there. So that's going to encourage or exhort Hosea to be the kind of prophet that God would have him to be. So God is saying, I'm going to speak to you in a very graphic terms of a reality that is presently, is going to be present in your life every single day. And it will exemplify Israel and her disobedience and her relationship with me. And so he's going to use him in this kind of way. And so, again, the land has committed harlotry. And therefore, how has it done that? Well, the people have departed from the Lord. And so God is showing Israel through Hosea what they are planting in their country. And they were planting the things that were made for sin and made for judgment. And that's what takes place when we plant sin. You can believe that we're going to reap the judgment that will take place. And so, interesting that through this particular time, Israel is very wealthy. It was a time of great peace and prosperity in the midst of the countryside, and the natural enemies are weakened at this particular point. And so therefore, they have a great opportunity to build their country, to build up the wealth, and they are doing that. And so we see the comfort that is there. And when things are going very well for them, therefore, it seems as though they forget about God and continue to live lives in ways that are departing from God. Verse 3, so he went, took Gomer, and she conceived, bore him a son, named, well, first of all, Gomer, name is, depends on where you get the translation from, but one says it's completion, and another one says that it is destruction, and another says signifies failing or consuming. And so either way, it's coming to an end as far as their sin goes and their country goes, basically, because the end is near. They can have signs out right now, and Hosea could be carrying a sign saying, you know, the end is near. The end of this country is near, and that's basically what he's saying when he is prophesying here and calling these folks to account and to repentance. So Gomer is completion. And talk about more about the idea symbolically of failing and the consumption of the people and the complete disobedience that they are involved in. And so the so it's not present at this particular time, but the prophetic word and the idea of Gomer being part of that prophetic word is the idea that it is going to soon be experiencing the idea of great failing and great corruption and all of the people. And so, which certainly happened by the Assyrians in 722 B.C. when they were destroyed. And so this is just before that takes place. Hosea is the prophet prophesying to them about this this destruction that is coming. Verse 4, then the Lord said to him, call his name Jezreel. That is the son of Gomer and Hosea. For in a little while, I will avenge the bloodshed of Jezreel on the house of Jehu and bring an end to the kingdom of the house of Israel. And so call his name Jezreel. And so Jezreel is meaning scatter. So the idea that they are going to be scattered, and he says it right out. This isn't the last chapter of Hosea. It's the first chapter of Hosea. And he puts it right out front. This child that is being born is the name of the very idea that God has in mind for the nation of Israel. So right up front, he puts this this to them, saying, you're going to be scattered. You're going to be scattered throughout the nations. And yet, will they repent? The mystery is still unfolding, you know, as we read about these things. Well, I just told you 722, they get, they are destroyed. But Jezreel means scattered, and so Israel would soon be scattered in exile by the Assyrians, as I mentioned. And then Jezreel refers also to the Valley of Jezreel, as you remember, when Jehu became the king, that he destroyed the dynasty that he destroyed the Ahab dynasty and all, and he put Jeroboam in control. And so that's how he got hold of the throne at this particular point. And so the massacre that took place and the destruction that took place of Jehu, and so therefore that's why all this is taking place, also because of the judgment that was pronounced upon Jehu for the destruction of all the folks in the bloodline of the king. And so the idea again of Jezreel, a scatter, but also it can be mentioned also as plant or sowing or to sow. And so that's important later on because obviously of what God is going to do. And one thing we need to realize about our God, as he does here, even in this first chapter, there's a lot of ungodly things taking place in Israel. And he names Jezreel, scatter. Gomer, completion, waste. Your time is up, in other words. You've completed your time, basically. But there's also a twofold ministry in that, just the word. And that's the idea of not just which we'll get to later, but not just the idea of Jezreel meaning scattering or scattered, but it also means plant. And so the idea of planting afresh for the nation of Israel and the people of Israel also. So that's going to be brought up also later on in a different way. In verse 5, it shall come to pass in that day that I will break the bow of Israel in the valley of Jezreel. I will break the bow of Israel, he says. And the valley of Jezreel, it's you probably recognize this story by the name. Jezreel is Armageddon, the valley where the final battle is going to take place. And there were many battles there that had happened already. Many people fighting. That's a place, obviously, of contention and war and places where they go to battle, big open space. And verse 6, and she conceived again and bore a daughter. Then God said to him, call her name Lerahama, for I will no longer have mercy on the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away. And so again, the name of the daughter, Lerahama, and the name is No Pity or Unloved is another wording for it. Not pitied, no unloved. And so therefore, you get the idea that Hosea's family life isn't going to be very good. I mean, he's naming his son Scattered, and then the daughter that comes along is not pitied or unloved, and then the next one's going to be kind of the same thing. And so here you have a bunch of kids, and every day you're going to say, hi, kids, and it reminds you of what they're named for, because you have to call them by their name every single day. And so here we have, a real contention within the household. And as you have this kind of a line of work, let's call it that, he's a prophet, and so you got to do what God's going to tell you to do, and you're going to say what God tells you to say, and you're going to name your kids what God tells you to name your kids. And so therefore, it's like it's out of his hands. And does Gomer understand that? You know, it'd be kind of tough on a family to live with unloved. And so right away, he calls his daughter, no pity, unloved, would you come here? Kind of thing. And so I'm sure this would be something that is being, I am unloved, the daughter would be thinking. And the son would be thinking, so I'm just scattering things around, And so I wait until we get the next one. So it's interesting how God works in these areas and the things that he is expected to do. And you know that the trials and problems, you already know that they're trials and problems of prophets. But this is a little bit different. Normally, the trials and problems of the prophet is when you're speaking to the people, and now they come against you because they're of what you said, because of what God has told you to say. You're speaking the things of God and the reaction there. But you go home, you see. Well, he goes home, and this is what he goes home to. And so here we have this kind of a continual direction and life of a prophet. And so in verse 3, we see that Jezreel is mentioned is, it says Hosea and Gomer. But the other children, it does not say is from particularly Hosea and and Gomer. It says that they're born, but it doesn't say specifically that it was born from Hosea. So there is some issues there. Certainly could have been illegitimate children, the last two. But it's not told to us that specifically, but here there's a lot of speculation in all of that, and you can speculate with all those things, but it doesn't say that directly, so we don't need to say those things directly. And so I will have mercy on the house of Judah, he says in verse 7, will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor by sword or battle, by horsemen by horses or horsemen. So he's going to save them, but not Israel. And so Israel continues to ignore the request and the direction of repentance and coming back to the Lord. It continually does that. In fact, this is just in that particular same thing, the Assyrians attacked Judah along with the idea of Israel. And they defeated Israel, but they did not defeat Judah. And why didn't they defeat Judah? In 2 Kings 19, it tells us about an interesting thing that took place. They were about to be defeated, Judah was, and they were ready to be defeated that very night. But an angel of the Lord came out and destroyed 150,000 soldiers in the camp of Assyria that very night. If you remember that in Scripture, it's 2 Kings 19:35. But yet, that's what the Lord just had told Hosea. I will save Judah. I'll work on their behalf. They're not going to have their army fight against them. And so, as it mentioned in that kind of way, he said, and I will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor sword, nor or battle, nor horses, or horsemen. How do you save them? By the angel going through that night and destroying 185,000 Assyrians. That's how he saved them. See, our Lord is able to save. What we need to do is be faithful and walk closely with God. And he is the one that is going to be the one who fights for us. And in verse 8, now when she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah, she conceived and bore a son. And so she called his name Lo-Ammin. And well, in verse 9, it says, then God said, call his name Lo-Ammi, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. Now, you give that name to a person, and I think the guy would feel like maybe he's not really wanted. You're not my, you know, you're not my son if you name someone like that. And therefore, this is all a demonstration, though, for the house of Israel. And Israel is being called by God. You're not my son. You're not my my people. And so therefore, I will not be your God. You're not my people. I will not be your God. And so this is not much of a sentence or much of a penalty, so to speak, to them, as Guzik had said. I got this from him. It isn't as if people really wanted to be the people of God, yet God will not have them. Instead, the people of Israel rejected God, and here the Lord simply recognizes that fact. He won't play let's pretend. You pretend to be my God, and I'll pretend to be your God. So I'll pretend to be you pretend to be my people, and I'll pretend to be your God. And so the time for those games is over, and the time for those games was over, because God is ready to judge them for the things that are going on. And so in verse 10, yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured or numbered. And it shall come to pass in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people. There it shall be said to them, you are sons of the living God. In verse 11, then the children of Judah and the children of Israel shall be gathered together and appoint for themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land, for great will be the day of Jezreel. And so these promises of God, again, you have this mixing, this sowing, this weaving in and out of God's grace and God's judgment. He never leaves it just, okay, you're going to die, you deserve death, so therefore repent, you deserve death. And yet, he says, you're not my people, but you will be my people. You'll all come together at one particular time and place. And we see that that is going to take place in the end times. And so God is going to bring these, the house of Israel together, the tribes of Judah and the tribes of the northern ten kingdom. And so he's going to bring them all together, and they're going to be one people. And so we're going to stop there and pick it up next time. But we can look for a lot of the judgment taking place. As I say, I'll try to be relating it to the things that we are going through here as a nation, and also the things that Israel has gone through. And certainly it is the judgment of Israel in this particular time. So we start with a family. Hosea works through the family. And God works through the family as showing these things. So amazingly, we're all part of a family here today. So as we have the time for the worship team coming and all, we can recognize that God calls all to repent. And as the warning call went out, set the trumpet to your mouth is what Hosea said in chapter 8, verse 1. He says, you sow the wind, you'll reap the whirlwind. It's so much easier and better to be in a place that we're obedient to the Lord, has a good relationship with God. So that's what we want to be. And today, this morning, we want to consider that. Consider our relationship with God, that it is solid, that it is one that we want to keep well informed of the scriptures and well prayed up by prayer every day, devotions every day, and that's one way that we have of building up our most holy faith. So let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Father, I thank you that you're our present help, Lord God, that you're the one that is able to bring to us such peace and joy. And Lord, in the end, we know, God, that all this wrestling and all the things that are not pleasing, Lord, it's not really worth it at all, God. And we just thank you that you work in our lives, that you have us to have these kind of areas of scripture that shows the way that you work, your desire to have a relationship with your people, Lord God, and we are your people, Lord. We thank you, God, that you have blessed us with your presence, that you've asked us to come in, and you've invited us in to have relationship with you, God, and we want to invite you in on a daily basis with us. And so we thank you, God, for that. And I pray this morning, God, that there is anyone here, they don't know you as their Lord and Savior, that they would understand that you are the one that is present right now for them, Lord God. We understand that you've said the wages of sin is death, that all have sinned, that there is none righteous, not even one. There's none who calls upon you, Lord, but you are the one that got our attention. And you've told us that all who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So So Lord, as we ask you to touch our lives, and Lord, we ask and believe that you are there, that you are the one that is able to do above and beyond all things in our lives, that you're able to forgive us of our sins, to remove the guilt and the shame that is upon our lives, Lord. And as was mentioned earlier, Lord, for all manner of sin and blasphemy will be forgiven. And so, Lord, as we acknowledge that we are blasphemers, that we are those who have sinned, but Lord, we know that you're the one that will accept us. And as we trust you for all things, and Lord, as we confess our sins, that you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So this morning, if there's anyone here, you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, but you want to. You want to know him. You want to have that intimate relationship with a living God. God is here for you. He has that plan. He has that purpose for you in your life. And he stands ready to show you, to reveal himself to you in a very real way. So this morning, if there's anyone here, you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you want to know him, I'm going to ask you to make that public to us. Just to raise your hand and say, yes, I need prayer. I know that I need Jesus in my life today. I don't have a relationship with the living God, but I want to know him today. So this morning, it's your opportunity to have that relationship with the living God. Anyone at all, before we close, just to raise your hand and say, you know, that's me. I need prayer. I need Jesus in my life right now. Anyone at all, before we close, just to raise your hand. We'll pray for you. All right, let's stand and worship the Lord in closing. And if you need or would like prayer, come on down and we'll be down here to pray for you and to lay hands on you.